Everyone, we want to begin the service with a reminder to turn all your cell phones off, if you don't mind, or at least turn them down to silent or vibrate. And a reminder, too, that all the children will remain in the service for today. Our prayer missionary for today is Jim and Mary Garrison from Germany. They actually have been supported by this church longer than I've been here. When I came, they were already missionaries. And we have Jerry and Sherry Daniels with us somewhere. Heard it right over here again today. Great. It's always wonderful to have them here with us. I want to give you a special prayer request praise report before we pray. Caden Turner, who is the grandson of Gary and Sharon Turner, he has a childhood leukemia, and for about the last 3 years has been going through different procedures, and as of right now, it's in full recession, and he's doing great. I want to thank the Lord, and the Turners want to make sure that you know that they appreciate your prayers for little Caden. For this morning's prayer, we want to pray for our president, vice president, members of Congress, as always, and pray for our missionaries around the world, and pray for those in our church family who you might not know, but they could be struggling with something very profound this very day, or facing something this week. And if a church member comes across your mind, just pause for a minute and pray for them. No such thing as a wasted prayer. Let me ask for those who'd like to find a place here to pray in the front. We'll open the service in prayer this morning, asking God to bless the service, to give us guidance and assistance and help, and that every one of us will grow to love the Lord and one another even more intensely. You can find a place to pray here or pray right where you're seated. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the privilege of prayer. We thank you that in a busy, hurried week, we can pause, even in a structured service, to silence our hearts before you, to bow our heads, and to express our dependence upon you, our trust in you, and our worship of you. And we do pray that in this morning service, through the music, the fellowship, the prayer time, and the sermon, that you will be exalted, that you will rise supreme in our hearts and minds, and that we will truly leave thanking you and worshiping you for all you have done for us. We pray for our president and vice president and members of Congress, all of whom need your controlling spirit, even those who are not Christians, that you will govern and guide and move in their lives in such a way that your will is performed. We pray for our missionaries around the world, particularly Jim and Mary Garrison in Germany, and the Daniels who are with us today, that you'll bless each one of these families who have invested their lives in foreign lands, far away from their own family and friends, to be used by you to touch people's lives, and may you give them all great fruitfulness today. We thank you for how you've worked in Caden's life, and that prayer list that we have on our own church family of so many who need your intervention. We thank you that you are the God who can do anything at any time, any way you please, for anybody you please, as often as you please, because you are the supreme sovereign authority over all the universe. We acknowledge you today as our Lord, and we ask you be pleased in what we say and do today. For we ask that in Jesus' name, amen. Let me ask you to please stand up so you can welcome all those around you. Make sure everybody feels welcome before we go into the song service this morning. Thank you.
kingdom goes on and on and on and on. And nothing can shake God. Nothing can deter his plan for his people. Nothing can take him off his throne. There's so much confidence in that this morning. So as we sing this next song, let's just have that in our minds. As we sing, in Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. Whatever you're going through this morning, whatever you're facing, every solution is found in Jesus. Let's sing this together. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my soul. This cornerstone, this solid crown, firm through the fiercest trial and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ.
To prepare for this morning's offering, and let's bow our heads in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, as we present our offerings to you today, we want to do so out of a spirit of gratitude, of celebration, of joy, of faith, and purpose. We thank you for the privilege of giving and that we actually have something to give when there are many around the world who don't have anything to bring to church to give, who can't meet their daily bills or feed their families, and they struggle in great poverty with no hope of ever getting out, and we live in such affluence. We thank you for this blessing. Help us to hold on to our possessions with a loose grip and give back to you what would honor you. And may we do so in our offerings today. May you bless each person who gives. Bring us all to the point where we can give more of our time and our talents and our treasures to the corporate ministry and our individual lives as we interact with others. May this offering please and honor you today, for we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. Great to be back in Sarasota and be back at a Faith Baptist Church. Last week we were in Buffalo at a church we helped plant 30 years ago, and I was reminded of the wonderful characters that come in and out of of life. And people we saw who we started that church with, it just, some of them made me laugh just looking at them, the things they said and did. And then I was reminded of some of the characters here. I mean, our church is full of characters. And one of them I mentioned to you a couple of weeks ago that he said as soon as he closes his eyes for the last time, he'll be slap dab in the presence of the Lord Jesus, Richard Barron. Well, that's where he is today. And Richard went home to be with the Lord last Friday, the day that I was leaving for Buffalo. His passing was quick and his family was there. But Richard is one of those characters, probably the smartest man I've ever actually met in a real live personal conversation. Richard was an expert on everything you could think of. He was an astounding person, quirky, a lot of fun, and he had become a dear friend, and he had served as a trustee in our church, and many of you he'd interacted with at times. And there were times on Wednesday nights I'd deliver an entire message, and then Richard would raise his hand to add something to it, and I could see people's eyes roll back, like, oh, he's going to say something. But he always said something very profound and very succinct, and it always added and complemented the message. But along with Richard, we had two other deaths this week. Rose Pearson, who moved away just a few months ago because of her health to be with family, Rose passed away, and Julie Shaw passed away. That's Mike Shaw's wife. Mike is a former trustee of the church who you haven't seen much the last year because his wife required 24 hours a day, 7 days a week care, and he's been pretty much homebound with her. But he told me to tell you that you're going to see him soon. But his wife went home to be with the Lord. And those of you who know Mike's story, there's a miracle aspect to all of that, to their reunion and to their restored relationship and her faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And she went home to be with the Lord as well. I was counting up, or I had Terry count up for me. Since December, we've had 9 deaths in our church and 18 people have moved away. That leaves sort of a sinking feeling in your heart to interact and love one another, and slowly, one by one, they begin to disappear. But the wonderful thing is we know where those who passed are. They are with our Lord and Savior. I want to ask you to stand for just a moment, if you would, and turn in your Bibles or on your iPhone or iPad or whatever device you might have to Matthew chapter 6 as Matt reads from us verse 25 through 34.
Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, nor about your body, what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air, for they neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Which of you, by worrying, can add one cubit to his stature? So why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the fields, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin, and yet I say to you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Now if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore do not worry, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink, or what shall we wear? For after all these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble.
Amen. Thank you, and please be seated. I also want to encourage you, if you were not here last Sunday, go on the website and watch the message that Josh Longnecker preached last week. It was full of so much rich, deep truth, historical references, and biblical analogies, and I think it was a great message. I enjoyed watching it. And if you weren't here, please go back and watch that. The passage we just read from Matthew chapter 6, the word that jumps off the page is worry. And worry is the contemplation of things you fear might happen that you don't want to happen, or it's the fear that things won't happen that you want to happen. And it's a focused concentration on basically the future. Worry has a real close friend that goes with it everywhere it goes, and it's called stress. Although stress also follows moments of exhilaration and moments of success, stress most often is associated with worry. And for a believer, we need to respond to that tendency that we all have to worry. Stress is a serious physical and mental health concern. Americans spend billions each year trying to cope with or deal with stress. Physiologically speaking, stress is the over-arousal of the adrenal system, which releases adrenaline into the body to help it cope or react or respond to a perceived or actual challenge or change or threat or a moment of exhilaration. The stress that comes from the adrenaline helps you respond to it, but adrenaline is a drug. And you must come down from adrenaline like any other drug. And you can get addicted to adrenaline like you can any other drug. Some people say adrenaline is actually one of the most powerful drugs on the planet. Its effects can lead to headaches, stomach aches, muscle tension, sleep problems, and even depression. You can get high blood pressure, heart disease, obesity, diabetes, and many other organ issues from unrelenting stress. The Holmes-Rey Stress Scale is a real simple way to measure somebody's psychological stress. As a matter of fact, we're going to use it today in Sunday school after the morning service. It has a life events on it in a list, and the life events are given a numerical quotient that is an estimate of the degree of stress that that change causes. And all these life events are simply changes that occur in your life. So you go down the list and you check each one that has happened to you in 1 year. And then you add up the numerical quotients that go along with it. Whatever that final number is that you add up, that will tell you what your statistical likelihood is of having a major physical breakdown or mental breakdown or disease. And over time, it's proven to be incredibly accurate. The problem is when you take the Holmes-Rey stress scale and your number tells you you're in line for a major physical problem, you just now have added more stress. If you get a 150, that's good. 300 is considered very, very bad. The last time I took it, I was at 475. And so since then, I haven't taken the Holmes-Rey stress test since, eliminating some stress in my life. But it tells you what change does. Change is the culprit of stress. The more traumatic the change, and the more frequently the change occurs in your life, the more adrenaline is released into your body. And your adrenal glands, if they dump out completely, they have to rebuild and restore. They don't have an infinite supply. They must create more adrenaline. You and I are creatures of routine and familiarity and what we perceive to be security. So things that change on us, they make us think that what we are expecting might not happen. We don't like change. And if you think, well, I don't mind change at all, just think about whenever I move the chairs around here or whenever you can't sit in the seat you normally sit in, just that little, that moment of tension that hits you, like, and then you finally calm down, the Holy Spirit ministers to you and you're able to sit someplace new. But something that subtle, how it can and bother you. Well, change can create tremendous amount of stress, which is adrenaline, which then does something to you physically, mentally, and spiritually. We think we know the outcomes of our familiar routines, but we really don't. All we know are probabilities. There's nothing really certain in life, except that Alabama will be ranked number one when the football season starts, and Trump is not going to be liked by anything he says, thinks, does, or wishes, or hopes for. He'll be trounced in the media for that. Other than that, everything is uncertain. The future is wide open. You don't know what you think you know. And then once you hear that and believe that, that adds more stress to you. Stress is a cycle that continues to churn up in your heart, mind, and body. The current generation is not only dealing with the life events that you and I dealt with, but they are also dealing with the fastest changing culture in human history. Not only is our world changing faster than ever before, but we have greater exposure and awareness of all the changes and all the options and all the solutions and all the issues are now readily available 24 hours a day. The result is and can be a profound, debilitating, and even depressing stress. And psychologists are now telling us that there's this phenomenon taking place in young America of stressed out teenagers and 20-somethings, that they can't grasp what's in front of them because they are so stressed out. Just look at how much the world has changed since I came here 25 and a half years ago. When I first came, I had a full head of luscious red hair that was the envy of the land. And now I have, you know, a faithful remnant clinging on for dear life. But the Dow Jones Industrial Average 25 and a half years ago was 3,027. Today it borders at 20,000. A new home cost $120,000 in America. Now the average price is $368,000. A new car cost $16,000 25 years ago. Today it costs $35,000. The United States population was 252 million. Today it's 325 million. The world population was 5.5 billion. Today it's 7.2 billion. In 25 more years, it'll be more than 10 billion people on the planet. But all those are superficial changes. There are more profound changes. When I came to Sarasota 25 years ago, the Twin Towers still stood. No one had ever heard of Al-Qaeda, ISIS, Jihad, Boko Haram. No one could even imagine beheadings or driving a truck into a European crowd or flying a plane into an American building. Marriage was still defined as between a man and a woman. iPhones, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and all of those social media things, and the internet itself, were just sort of fuzzy dreams in the minds of computer geeks. Today, those things are all reality. But even more troubling changes have occurred. Political correctness has now taken over public discourse. The only group that is not shielded by the police speech, the speech police, is Christians. You can say whatever you want about conservative, Bible-believing Christians, but everybody else you must not offend. The idea of absolute truth has been dismissed. There is no defensible right or wrong when it comes to morality and faith anymore in America. Islam is America's fastest growing religion. Estimates are that there are some 9 million Muslims in America now, and by 2050, they will outnumber Christians in the United States. Biblical Christianity is considered hateful and a deterrent to personal freedom. Universalism is considered the best understanding of God's love, if he or she even exists. Homosexuality is a societal norm, and sex change operations are applauded. Being gender fluid is now considered to be the most open-minded, sexually mature way to approach your sexuality. Those are all huge changes in the last 25 years. All that has taken place while America has exploded with megachurches. How could that be? Well, part of the problem is we have fewer Christians in America than we did 25 years ago. And the percentage of Americans who call themselves Christians is even lower because the population has grown so much. So the church has a louder voice, but we have less influence. We are media savvy, but we no longer have the savor of good salt. We are very flashy, but we seem to have lost our substance. So in the middle of all this great change, the church has sort of faded into the background. And then this other thing that I want to emphasize for a moment, technology. Technology is changing faster than any time in world history, and it's changing so fast that we have to adapt to it and embrace it before we have the opportunity to even assess if that technology is good or bad. It's part of our lives before we know it. And it's gotten so fast that once we embrace something, a new technology is released, as we're holding it in our hands, we're looking for the improved 2.0 version. There's no way even to measure the degree of discontent and instability that causes in a human heart to have something in your hands but always be looking at what's coming next. You can't even appreciate what you have at the moment. And that's tough for any generation to handle, but especially for those who are being raised right now. It was only 10 years ago that the iPhone was introduced. 10 years ago. And now iPhone is on number 7 and Samsung is on the Galaxy 8. It took 60 years for Bell Telephone to go from the rotary dial to the push button. And iPhones and Samsungs have gone into 8 generations in less than 10 years. And next year in 2018, there will be 3 billion iPhones or Samsung Galaxies in the world. So we live under the threat of not embracing technology and therefore being left out of the social discourse, of missing certain important information, of not being fully equipped to have a job, to not being able to contact your friends and know what's going on. And that's not so bad if you're my age, but imagine being born and growing up in that kind of culture where you must have instant access and instant response and instant information to everything that's going on. What does that do to the mind? What is that? How can you calm down and relax even for a day when you realize that 24 hours of things are happening that you're unaware of that everybody else is? Well, for many generations, that was just everyday life. You didn't know what happened that day until you watched the 6 o'clock news. Now the news comes at you all day long on your phone as you're just walking around. You're getting updates on the news. And often the news, of course, is not very good. Social media is inundating our culture with comparative information and images all day long. And by comparative, I mean you can look what others have and what others are doing and what you have and what you are doing anytime, all day, every day. And you can do it with your friends and you can do it with complete strangers. At any given time of the day, we can know where somebody else is, what they're doing, what they feel like, what they look like, and how much more fun they're having than we're having at any time in the day. Now, for those of us who are older, you might not be tempted to know that, but young people are tempted profoundly to be in contact with that. It's the desire humans have for intimacy. And intimacy is being replaced by a virtual world of connectivity rather than really human flesh interaction. And there's no reason to ridicule it. There's no reason to mock it. It is the reality of the day, and it's the world that our young people are being raised in. So how is the church going to address that? Are we going to prepare ourselves for it? Because of social networking, young people are exposed to a greater variety of political views, philosophical posits, religious beliefs, and moral definitions than any previous generation. You had to go to the library and find a book to read up on some variant view before. Now it's readily available. They have more medical advice. They have more dietary advice. They have more health advice and relationship advice readily accessible than can actually be healthily assessed. It's a tsunami of information. And all these variant views are presented more persuasively than ever. Celebrities are no longer just entertainers. Celebrities are now guides for culture. They give us our moral parameters. They espouse political wisdom, even though many of them are celebrities for having done nothing more than becoming famous or for portraying somebody who actually did something. You know, the joke from 20 years ago is, I'm not a doctor, but I play one on TV. That's now legitimate credentials. You have authority to speak on something because you played a part in a movie or a TV show. The influence of the video stars on Facebook, YouTube, YouTube Red, Periscope, Meerkat, Chromecast, Vimeo, BuzzNet, BuzzFeed, Flickr, and that's just to name a few. There's a whole world out there of information being broadcast on the internet that have sidestepped the networks and even cable TV. They have a greater influence on young people than their parents, their peers, and their pastors. And these mediums offer up very clever, very creative, very likable, very happy people who present their views very, very persuasively. And those views are often different than what the young person is hearing at home or at church. So how can the young person not help but ask, am I really sure what I've been told is right? So they question everything. And instead of hearing 2 opinions, they'll hear 30 opinions. After using Facebook and Instagram for a while, those who post things start to draw their sense of well-being from how many likes or views they received rather than from what they actually did in a day. And that's not a generational thing. That's a human response to social media. But you and I weren't raised in social media. But the young people who are, that's the way they're going to be formed, by likes and views and the branding of self on social media. It is a way of life. The church can ignore it, the church can deny it, the church can make fun of it, or the church can respond to it in some kind of meaningful way that gives this next generation something to put their feet on where they can stand strongly. Americans have always dealt with something called option anxiety. That's having so many opportunities or so many experiences, so many products and options available, that decision-making turns into a mini crisis. We've always had that, but never to this degree, because the options are now infinite. Colleen and I went to a restaurant in Akron, New York that we love called Guy Sub. And we used to always go there, and we knew the menu pretty well. We walked in, and the menu had expanded like four times. Well, I knew what I wanted when I went in there, but when I saw the menu, I didn't know what I wanted anymore. It was a stress of, well, and so too many options creates this stress in you. Well, if I make decision A, decision B or C or D or C might be better, and what I'm choosing might not be the best thing available, and it might sound funny, but that creates stress. Something that you've often heard, paralysis by analysis. There's too many options, makes you think so long, you end up not making a decision or making one, but being fairly sure they didn't make the right one. But you got to live with it. Young people today are growing up with that. And a deep discontent goes into the heart and the mind where what was once good is no longer good enough. Or worse, what was once good is now bad because of all the other options I've seen that have been presented more effectively, creatively, and persuasively. So many millennials today are just choosing to dispose of their previous beliefs, the previous principles, and the practices of their parents, and start over from scratch. Just deconstruct it all and do it right this time, or at least do what's right for them. And can you blame them? Have we really done that good of a job of identifying the basic essentials of life, love, and faith? Have we lived by those things once we identified them? And have we really communicated it to our young people? I don't think we have. It's one of the things that really troubles me. And in my mind, I've written a book. And I'm getting stressed out about it because I haven't written it yet. But it's in my mind. It's in my head. And it's entitled Passing the Baton, Leaving Something Worthy for the Next Generation to Carry Forward. And the questions I wonder about is, how can one have peace in a world that is full of stress? How can one have any sense of certainty when everything you hear and see makes you uncertain? And why are people that I love, admire, and like wrong just because they have different values and beliefs than mine? Those are severe questions that my generation and the one before didn't really have to answer. This generation has to answer it every day and then find some place to plant their feet and say, this is me, when they don't even know who they are. So what I want to say today, and it's going to be a couple of weeks' message, nothing faced by this generation or the one before this one, mine or the one prior to it, or any generation coming up, nothing that any of us have ever faced or will face can nullify, negate, or overwhelm the peace of God that has sustained believers in every situation, every circumstance, and every era for 2,000 years. There's nothing new under the sun in terms of its base core challenge, but there are new ways it's being presented. None of them are greater than what God can give. None of the questions the next generation is going to face, none of the solutions they're going to seek, none of the alternatives they're going to hear, none of the options they're going to have, not even the unprecedented pace of change will eliminate scriptural truth, the sovereignty of God, or the presence of His Spirit. And that's probably the longest sermon introduction I'll ever give here, but the rest of the part's not going to be long. But we need to look at now, what does the Bible say? Just this is just one answer I want to give today about this question I'm trying to wrestle with myself. What should we be telling the next generation? Do they need to hear that everything's okay and God's happy with you? Just enjoy your life. Or do they need to hear something else? Well, here's one answer. It's found in John chapter 14. And turn there if you would, or you can look up on the screen. 25 through 27. These things I have spoken to you while being present with you. But the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. This passage applied to the disciples and the apostles and the early church. This passage applied to those in the Dark Ages. This passage applied to those during the Renaissance, during the Enlightenment, during the age of the American Revolution, during the 1900s, and applies to those living in 2017, and it's going to apply to those who live in 2025 and 2040. This is absolute truth from God about something essential to our lives, and that's how we can have peace. So some things to keep in mind as we struggle with the issues that the world now presents to us. The peace that Christ gives is, first of all, only His to give. You can't get this anyplace else. You can't get it from the world. You can't get it from money. You can't get it from satisfaction. You can't get it from self-expression. You can't get it from wisdom. You can't get it from anything else other than Jesus Christ, the very Prince of Peace, the one who gave us peace with God, the one who gives us the peace of God, and the one who gave us peace with God. So the peace that Christ is talking about is His to give. It comes from Him. Therefore, to get it from Him, you must be right with Him. Even if that makes you wrong with Facebook. Even if it makes you wrong with YouTube. Even if it makes you wrong with your social circle out there in cyberspace. To be right with the peace giver is the most important thing. If you have that settled, everything can go wrong and you can be at peace. The peace that Christ gives is deeply rooted in what He said while on earth. So much to the point that the Holy Spirit is sent to remind us of what Jesus said on earth. His words are far more important than any news commentator, any radio voice, any internet, any YouTube star. The words of Jesus Christ, the peace He gives is intrinsically tied, deeply rooted to the words of the Lord Jesus Christ. But to receive that peace, you must be receptive to it. You must be reflective of it. And you must know it. The best way to know the words of Jesus are to read them. Read them for yourself. Read them in a book. Listen to them on tape. But familiarize yourself with the words of the Prince of Peace. Many of us can quote a lot of things that we've heard, read, and seen over the years, but we can't really quote the words of Jesus. I got a book given to me when I was in high school called The Words of Jesus and the Words of Mao. And it was a comparison of these two great leaders. And it was a striking book. When I read through the book, I realized I didn't know a lot of those things that Jesus had said. If there's one person you and I should be experts on, it's the Lord Jesus Christ, because we call ourselves Christian. Well, Pastor Dave, I don't understand the Bible. We're talking about Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And there's another phrase over there in Hebrews, I'll never leave you or forsake you, but that's just an echo of what you find in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. You can read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in a matter of a day and read those constantly to hear what did our peace giver say. The peace that Christ gives is intrinsically linked to the Holy Spirit. So it's not just knowledge, it's an interaction of the indwelling presence of God that feeds and fuels those words and make them come alive in you. Therefore, you and I must submit to the Holy Spirit. We must walk in the Holy Spirit. We must be controlled by the Holy Spirit. And He does all that with us through the Word of God that gives the parameters and the guidance and the light as a light to our a lamp to our feet and a light unto our path. That's God's word. So God's peace that Christ gives is only his to give. It's deeply rooted in what he said, and it's intrinsically tied to the Holy Spirit, which is why Paul said, don't grieve or quench the Holy Spirit, because then you shut off this valve from whom peace comes. The peace that Christ gives is different in essence and power than what the world gives. Jesus didn't say the world can't give you peace. What he says is, what I give you, the world can't give you. The peace that I give, the world can give you great peace. Standing in front of Niagara Falls, a beautiful mountain, a sunset on the beach. You can have a peaceful feeling where you just want to hear the waves lap against the shore and you feel better. Well, that's a peace the world can give, and it can give it to you because God designed it to give it to you. But there's a peace that comes from Jesus Christ only, that only he can give. And it comes rooted in his word and his presence, and it's very, very different than the world. The world can give you peace through knowledge. It can give you peace through a sense of certainty. It can give you a peace because you can see what's taking place. But whatever peace the world gives you is only temporary, because the world is always changing. I was reminded of that of this week when we went to Buffalo and saw the church that we helped plant and saw some old dear friends and then had three pass away while I was gone. Wherever you are, whatever situation, everything is in constant change. Things you want to hold on to, they dissipate while you're grabbing for them. Things you thought you had a hold of, you look back and they're gone. That's life. You cannot change that. You can't alter that. That's what, as time marches on, time equals change. Change equals stress. So we as believers must know how to deal with all that. Well, the peace that Christ gives is designed to impact our thoughts and our emotions. He said, don't be troubled and don't be afraid. There's a deep abiding serenity even when we're suffering for a believer. Of course, I've seen it many, many times in the years that I've been here with people who have died of long-term chronic diseases. I've been able to talk with them in the hospital and see the anguished, pained smile on their face, knowing that they're going to see Jesus, that everything is going to be fine, that God has been good to them. And it was so visible in Richard's testimony of his faith in the Lord. And with all his failures and all of his flaws, he knew somehow Jesus had saved him and given him a home in heaven. And he was good to go. Well, that's a peace the world can't give you, because it can't promise you the next life. It has no reference point for that. The philosophy of the world is you only go around once in life. And so grab, as that old beer commercial used to say, grab for all the gusto you can. But this once in life is like that compared to eternity. And we over-prioritize what we can get from this life sometimes. The peace that Christ gives is in him. Not just from him, it is in him, in his person, in his presence, in his provision, in his promises. The peace that Christ gives is rooted in him. You must be a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ to access and experience and sense and share this peace. To be a peacemaker, you must first have peace. And to have peace, you must first have the Prince of Peace, the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said in John chapter 16, verse 31 through 33, and a repeat of what he said in chapter 14, Jesus answered them and said, do you now believe? Indeed, the hour is coming, yes, has now come, that you will be scattered, each to his own, and you will leave me alone. And yet I am not alone, because the Father is with me. And that's a principle he's trying to relate to us. These things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. That's a passage we love. It's often on plaques in Christian bookstores and on signs, and people love to highlight it in their Bible, but we don't necessarily highlight the part about you're going to be scattered and there's going to be tribulation. But that's the context. He said, you're going to run for the hills in just a few hours. You're going to run fleeing for your lives. One of you, which we found out later in the Bible, is so he leaves so panicked, he leaves naked because they grab his coat and he keeps running and they rip the coat right off him. That's how panicked the disciples were at the arrest of Jesus Christ. He said, you're going to be scattered, but be of good cheer. I will give you peace. In the world, you are going to be scattered and have tribulation, but in me, you have peace. So Paul reflected on this in Philippians chapter 4 when he said, be anxious, and you can say, don't worry, be anxious for nothing, but in everything with prayer, supplication, and thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. If I had anything to say to the millennial generation or the one to follow even after them, is to trust God with questions that we did not have to face that you will. Our answers might not be the answers that are going to fix your issues of life, but this one I know will. This is going to apply regardless, that Jesus Christ is the Prince of Peace. He will give it. He will feed it. He will sustain it. He will grow it, and it will overcome your life where you can be in a stress-filled, anxiety-wrought world and have peace. You ask God for wisdom. You ask God for peace. You ask God for grace. You ask God for strength. And then you go looking for how to live that way out in the world that you are born into. The world I was born into was very different than my father's world. The world my son and my daughter were born into is going to be very different already than the world that is existing right now. Their children will be born into a world that you and I might not even recognize. But what remains the same? The gospel. So I wrote a rephrase of Matthew chapter 6 I want to read to you. It's not meant to be comical. It's not meant to be satirical. It's not meant to be smart alecky. It's not meant to thumb my nose at millennials. I just thought it might make it a little more applicable in terms of understanding. Therefore, I say to you, do not worry about getting everything right in the eyes of others. Isn't life more than a generation's values? Look at your parents. They didn't know or do everything right, yet the Father took care of them. Will you not receive the same grace? Which of you, by worrying, can solve all the great problems posted on the internet? So why do you worry about being wrong, about everybody else being right, or about you missing out? Consider the lilies of the field. They have no idea what's going on, but they were more glorious than Solomon, who did know what was going on. Now, if God can be pleased by the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow was thrown into the oven, can he not be pleased by you and your little faith? Do not worry about what you see on YouTube. Your heavenly Father knows the truth better than they. Seek the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and what really matters will become clear to you. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about its own things. It's hard enough just trying to figure out what to post today. The truth of the Word of God is the rock upon which we build our lives. Even in this ever-changing world, I have nothing but sympathy and empathy and a little bit of dread for the next generation because I can't foresee all that these changes are going to bring. All I know is it's going to happen faster than ever before and there will be absolutely no way to stop it. So the church has to have the wisdom that God can give, the peace to stand strong in this onslaught of change and be able to discern which changes should the church embrace, adopt, and utilize to carry out the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. What the world needs more than anything is the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. To know the Savior means you have to know that you're a sinner and you're not okay and your values are not acceptable and your behavior is not going to fly in the face of God without retribution. That God is a holy, just, righteous God who will judge, but he judged his son instead for everyone who believes. That's the message 2,000 years ago. It was a message during the Reformation. It was a message during the Great Awakening and the Second Great Awakening in America. It's the message today. The answer is Jesus. Let's bow together in prayer. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the certainty, the solidity, the concrete nature of the truth of your word. And although the church throughout history has gotten many, many things wrong, The one thing we can always fall back on is the gospel. And how that becomes the foundation of all that we are and all that we do, and how we respond to a world that is changing so fast we can barely even keep up. But Father, we know that the world is not changing faster than your ability to control it. And it makes no changes that you aren't aware of centuries before, millennia before, even throughout all eternity, that you didn't know ahead of time. Father, help us to rest in you. Help us to respond to this world of social media and supposed tolerance of all views except for ours. Help us to respond to that with grace, with strength, with peace, and with boldness. And maybe not worry. Maybe not be stressed. But instead find and experience and feel the peace that comes only because of Jesus. Now with our heads bowed and eyes closed, let me give you a moment to contemplate the words of this message in case something spoke to you directly. Ask God just to help you apply what you've heard. Discern the truth of it and what's applicable to you to implement. There's no question facing this next generation that God doesn't have the answer for. So run to Him. Heavenly Father, may you bless each person who came today with a peace of knowing you, of resting in you, of trusting in you. May we sense the presence of your Spirit in our lives because of what Jesus did on the cross. Today and for every stressor and life event we face in the years ahead. And Father, we ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. If you came today, by the way, and you're not certain, you're a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you're not really sure what it means to be born again, to be saved, to have eternal life, to have a home in heaven, or why a Christian can be so certain they're going to heaven, we would love to talk with you about that. You can call us, email us anytime, and be happy to meet with you here at your house, whatever's most comfortable for you. But we would implore you to trust in the Lord Jesus Christ at your earliest possible moment where you're aware of your need and of the answer. Let's all stand together to be dismissed with our morning blessing.
The Lord bless you. The Lord keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. And as we were talking about peace this morning, let's just focus our hearts and our minds on Jesus, on His word this week. Hope you guys have a good rest of your day today. Have a great week. Bless you guys and see you back here Sunday. Amen.